special place. However, we'd be here for days, so I don't think we'll embark upon that project. We do, however, want to take this occasion to recognize a very special group of Augsburg women, and three in particular. This year, the Augsburg Associates celebrate their 10th year anniversary. The membership, made up of alumni, parents, and friends of the college, are committed to friend-raising and fundraising. They have had an impressive record these past 10 years in both of these endeavors. They have successfully raised $350,000 for Augsburg College. $250,000 was for the purchase and the installation of the pipe organ in the Hoversten Chapel, and $100,000 was just raised this last year for the special collections room in the proposed new library. And they're now undertaking a project to furnish the green room in the Foss Center. All the while, they have been diligent in spreading the good news about Augsburg and reaching out to new graduates to join them on their crusade to help make a difference on our campus. Tonight, we want to recognize in particular the three founding members of the Augsburg Associates. It was through their leadership and vision that they realized the potential that Augsburg women could make things happen. And they launched an organization that would contribute to the growth and development of the campus for years to come. Catherine Anderson has been the longest standing member of the leadership board and has provided valuable continuity since its inception. Gladys Boxrood Strumman, class of 1946, is recognized for her outstanding leadership in the $250,000 organ fund drive, providing inspiration to all who worked on this very challenging project. And Stella Kylo Rosenquist, class of 1964, was instrumental in identifying and cultivating key individuals to join them on this venture. Would Kate and Gladys and Stella please stand so we can say thank you for all that you have done and continue to do for Augsburg. Here's Stella over here, and Kate and Gladys. And would all the members of the associates that are here with us tonight also please stand so we can recognize and thank you. There is one more special married alumni couple that I want to introduce to you this evening. Some of you have probably already received or will soon receive in the mail your invitation to join the 125th Anniversary Fund. We are pleased that Phil and Julia Sterland, who have accepted our invitation to chair our annual fund drive in this special anniversary year. Phil and Julia both graduated from Augsburg in 1979. Julia teaches at Minnehaha Academy, and Phil heads the strategic markets area for US West. We've asked them to just share briefly a few words with you this evening. Julia and Phil.
Thank you, and again, I want to warmly welcome you here and thank you for coming with the celebration that we have going this evening. And briefly, Phil and I are really honored and excited. We're co-hosting, the two of us, the new fundraiser for the 125th anniversary. And I hope that you will strongly consider supporting this fund. It goes throughout Augsburg and covers all of the different areas that they need support in at this point. Also, This institution played a vital role in both of our lives. We met here as freshmen and dated here for 4 years and were married after that. We both received our professional training here, which served us very well, I might say. And also, we made many, many lifetime friends at our time here at Augsburg, so we owe a lot back to this institution. Speaking of support, we are very pleased. Both of our parents are here this evening, and they were the ones who supported us financially and emotionally during our time here at Augsburg, and we're pleased that they could join us this evening.
As Donna mentioned, coming to a mailbox near you, if it hasn't already, is a letter announcing the 125th anniversary fund. As we all know, Augsburg has played a vital and a very important role in the fabric of the Twin City and Minnesota culture for 125 years. We ask, as we look at both the past and the future this evening, that you think thoughtfully, carefully, and prayerfully about a donation to Augsburg, so they can continue this role for the next 125 years. As Julie mentioned, we feel very fortunate this evening to be part of doing something to give back to a place that has given so much to us in our lives. I thank you in advance for your support, and good evening.
I've been asked to lead in the recognition of the 25th and 50-year reunion classes. First of all, to all of you, alumni from every class, let me say welcome home to Augsburg. We are honored and very pleased that you are with us as we begin the observance of the 125th year in Augsburg's history. We're also here really to recognize and to celebrate your history and the part that you have played in the life of Augsburg. Now, these comments about the classes, as far as I can tell, are drawn from observances, comments, and letters that members of the classes have conveyed back to staff. And I'm pleased to read what has been done with it. This is the class of 1944, description. The class of 1944 watched many of its classmates to go off to fight in World War II. And kept both the home fires and the midnight oil burning. During your time at Augsburg, you also shared the campus with soldiers attending the University of Minnesota, personnel who were housed in Memorial Hall, the scene of many of your late night study and bull sessions. Dorm life played an important role in your lives. Sievertson, Memorial, Morton, and West Halls were a center of friendship, studying, midnight snacks, recreation, and Saturday morning clean sweeps. Many a confidence was shared about those men or women who would become your spouses. As sophomores, you saw the crowning of Augsburg's first homecoming queen and took advantage of your position as upper-class men and women, wreaking havoc on the lives of freshmen, pinning braids on the men and putting men's shoes on the women. You eventually did relent, treating them to a party in the gym and final relief from your antics. The faculty were a strong and guiding influence during your lives here at Augsburg. After all these years, you still remember L. Lillehei saying, quote, sin is a bad thing, close quote. You remember Professor Sviggan being transported by literature and having to memorize the whole book of James for Cy Melby's religion class. Choir tours with Henry Opseth, classes from Professors Quanbeck and Ermish, Augsburg's first drama classes, and chapel talks by Dr. Christensen are also bright memories. Many of you listed fellowship and friendship as your favorite memories of Augsburg. It is a tribute to those friendships and to your time at Augsburg that you are here with us tonight, 50 years after your graduation. We salute you not only for who you were 50 years ago, but for who you have become. And would the class of 1944 please stand and be recognized?
Thank you. And what of the history of the class of 1969? You also were at college in wartime, but it was a very different war and had a very different reaction with many war protests and consciousness-raising activities. Your consciousness was also raised through community projects, the Crisis Colony, and groups such as the Black Student Union. Some of you hung out with, or perhaps even became, Augsburg's first hippies, and many of you have continued what you learned, serving the community through your careers or volunteer work. But your time at Augsburg wasn't always spent on serious issues, such as evidenced by your memories of dorm and house pranks, crawling in through windows after curfew, and all the society activities, rush week, fashion shows, talent shows, bridal shows, tournaments, and banquets. There were pies in the face, women in togas, apple polishing, teas, body painting booths, the dating game, and chopsticks lessons. Somehow during all of that, you found time to go to classes. You remember Professor Skibby's smile, sociology with Joel Torstensen and Vern Bloom, debating politics or political theory with Miles Stenschel and Norma Noonan, religion with Mario Colaci, band with Mayo Sovold, and athletics with Mrs. Pete. For some of you, coming to Augsburg meant learning about life in the city, and soon you became acquainted with downtown, Mama Rosa's, Smiley's Point, and the Triangle. You also watched the city come closer to you with the opening of I-94. But as with the class of 1944, the friends you made and that some of you married are some of the best memories of Augsburg. This is not simply a class reunion, it is a reunion of friends. Would the class of 1969 please stand and be recognized?
During the 1850s, they came, they saw,
they settled. They were young, gifted, and Lutheran.
Striking first into northern Illinois and southern Wisconsin, the steady stream of Lutherans pushed westward and northward over the prairies of Iowa, the Dakotas, and Minnesota.
They brought their Bibles, their catechisms, and their hymn books, but not enough pastors.
These settlers had to establish their own churches and their own communities with the idea of having a congregation and its attached pastor, precisely as in the old country. But the needs of the settlements far outpaced the supply of pastors who would come full of missionary zeal from Norway to the new land.
With a shortage of pastors, these Lutherans were truly exposed to a new world, to the religious and social influences of a brand new environment. They modeled their congregations on American churches of other denominations and sent their young men to be trained as pastors with the Germans in St. Louis and the Swedes in Illinois.
The danger of mixing foreign elements into the Lutheran faith and the question of a sufficient and efficient ministry became a matter of life and death to the Norwegian church in America.
You know, what we need is our own school.
Yeah.
A school in which Christian faith, pure Lutheran doctrine, and thorough theological training will be held fundamentally necessary for a true minister of the gospel.
Exactly.
A school where we Norwegians can speak and act as Norwegians, not as Swedes or German Norwegians.
Hoorah!
And so they came to Marshall, Wisconsin. August Vanus, as the sole professor, led a contingent of 19 students representing the Norse division of the Augustana Scandinavian Synod. But it was almost over before it started, thanks to dissension in the synod.
It was Swedes against Danes, Swedes against Swedes, Swedes and Danes against Norwegians, Norwegians against Norwegians, and the rival Norwegians held the title to the building. August Vanus, you and your students are hereby evicted from the Marshall Academy building. Surrender your key.
Well, that's fine with me. We've had only unpleasantness and loss from this American Academy. I know of a farmer named Cooper who has a great attic, and we'll continue the seminary there. Come along, gentlemen.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, all right. All right. Let's go.
Now, I know it's a little cramped in here.
You call this the student center?
No, that's the chapel. This is the student center.
Oh, well then, okay.
Now, come on, guys. Think of this as a test of our religious commitment and the will of the institution to survive.
Hear, hear, hear.
1 year later, that commitment faltered.
Gather around, everyone. It's been a tough year for me, what with teaching and preaching and administering and writing, not to mention the fact that the congregation's financial pledges have not come in. I'm sorry to say it, but we will have to discontinue operations.
No way.
After what we've been through?
And I just got used to the student center.
And what will the churches do without Norwegian-speaking pastors?
We can't give up now. What about all that talk last year about the will of the institution?
You're right. You're right. But we can't stay on here. We'll have to relocate to a better site. But the question is how and where.
We are meeting in this city on the 13th day of April, 1871, for the purpose of taking into consideration what steps should be taken to locate a Norwegian Lutheran college at this place. Therefore, be it resolved that efforts be made among the citizens of Minneapolis to secure the location of Augsburg Theological Seminary in this city and raise a sufficient sum here for that purpose.
September 15th, 1872. Augsburg Seminary begins the academic year in Minneapolis in the building now referred to as Old, really old. Maine. There are 24 students. Mayor Eugene Wilson accepts an invitation to speak at the ceremony dedicating the new campus.
I must thank you, the leaders of the school, for your pioneering enterprise. You of the Scandinavian race have taken the lead in giving us a theological institution. Any class of immigrant can be better trusted when accompanied by their ministers.
Oofta!
But then in 1874, three young men, bound together by ties of friendship and common views, were added to the faculty and began their duties at once.
Hello, President Venos. I'm Georg Sverdrup. Let me introduce my friend, Sven Rad Gunnarsson.
And I'm Sven Oftedal.
And together, the three of us can draft for you the interpretive statement of the board-approved program for Augsburg Seminary and its college departments. It will read something like this. We believe that our people who have left their native land to establish homes within a nation that will play a predominant role in world history must be given an opportunity to develop their potentialities. We believe that not a single one of the many nationalities in this country should lose its identity before having an opportunity to make a distinctive contribution to our evolving American culture. Hence, it is the obligation of our school to help Norwegian Americans find their place in the emerging American nation.
That program, as interpreted and approved, bore fruit for Augsburg College.
Augsburg Seminary is the center of a moral and intellectual influence among the Norwegian element of our city. The Minneapolis Journal, January 22, 1887.
The students of Augsburg Theological School have an excellent way of spending their vacations. They buckle on their armor and go out and do battle on behalf of the temperance cause.
Well, as faculty council leaders, we must respond to the Religious Life Committee in the following way. It is our opinion that there should be a natural, not a forced, but natural emphasis upon spiritual values in the Augsburg classrooms. Moreover, it is the council's belief that Spiritual Emphasis Week should not exempt Augsburg students from their academic responsibilities.
All right.
Dr. Philip Quambeck.
Augsburg has never been like some colleges with strong religious ties. Those which ask their teachers to sign a pledge that they agree with the principles and beliefs of the particular institution. That's not the Augsburg way. Augsburg, for all its heritage of piety, also has a tradition of freedom.
Dr. Luther Arnold.
I guess it never occurred to me to make comparisons between Augsburg and other colleges or the University of Minnesota. I just assumed Augsburg was the greatest because it concerned itself with the whole man.
And woman.
With a heavy emphasis on his.
And her.
Spiritual nature.
Dr. Joel Torstensen.
What excites me about a place like this is that it provides an exciting and relevant encounter with the Judeo-Christian legacy, as well as other aspects of our heritage. This is not a dead past to be defended against challenges of change, but rather a vital, living worldview with which to face the future.
Gerda Mortensen, Dean of Women.
You know, Augsburg is second to none in its devotion and fidelity to mission work. And there's no family more dedicated to bringing the Christian method to others than the Helland family. And we are lucky enough to have Melvin Helland with us tonight. Melvin, where are you? Did you know that there are three missionary sons in the Helland family spread all over the world? In fact, the sun never sets on the Helland family.
Ms. Mortensen?
Yes, Melvin.
That's because God doesn't trust the Hellands in the dark.
Mr. George Sverdrup.
In closing, I would like to say something. Something I think you should all take with you, hold close to your hearts, and remember. The past is alive in the present and has no doubt in the future. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Munga Tusen Tuck.
From her childhood Seward neighborhood to Augsburg College, class of 1976, to the Fifth Ward on the north side of Minneapolis, right on up to the president of the Minneapolis City Council, our own Jackie Parker Cherry Holmes has made us proud. Please join me in welcoming Jackie as she brings us a special proclamation from the city of Minneapolis, Augsburg's hometown.
Good evening. It's a pleasure to be here with you this evening on this important occasion. I look out and there are so many people. I guess I hadn't been expecting this larger crowd. I get to do a lot of these proclamations and honors and speaking engagements, but none are as important to me as the ones that I do for Augsburg College. As Donna said, I was sort of raised at Augsburg College. My mother taught in the library and taught children's literature here for something around 20 years and later became the academic dean. And I remember many, many days where I was in the library with her, and that was where my love of books came from and where I first came to know the college. I also spent many evenings in this gym watching basketball games and feel a great spirit in being here this evening. A lot of institutions have mottos. Education through service is Augsburg's motto, and I think that that motto is very important in my life because I am in a life of public service, and I would not be in that life were it not for the leadership and the education that I received at Augsburg College. I think about professors I had like Miles Stenshall and Norma Noonan, who inspired me to a career of public service. And I would not have had the ability, the knowledge, or the stamina to embark on that career had it not been for the love and the support and the encouragement of professors like I had at Augsburg College. So the motto of education through service has a great personal meaning to me. I know it also has a great meaning to Congressman Martin Szabo, who has asked me to express his regrets of being unable to be here this evening. He was not sure when Congress was going to adjourn, and so it was difficult to get a flight back in time for this event, but he sends his best greetings and wishes that he could be here with you this evening, too. So I want to congratulate the school on their 125th anniversary, and more than that, I want to thank you for all you've done for me as an individual and as a public service, and for the support that I continue to get from individuals who are connected to this important institution. You are truly an urban college, and I am very proud to have you in the city, to be part of Augsburg College, and to do everything I can to help you grow and expand and continue to meet the needs of our changing city. So I would like to present this proclamation, and I think I'm supposed to present it to Dr. Anderson. And I saw him go behind the curtain. So maybe he will appear from behind. There he is.
Hi, how are you?
The proclamation reads, in honor of Augsburg College and their 125th anniversary celebration, whereas the institution now known as Augsburg College was founded 125 years ago, and whereas for nearly all of that quarter century and a half, the college has been located in the city of Minneapolis, and whereas Augsburg's steadfast commitment to providing education through service has benefited the city, the region, and the world, and whereas Augsburg College shares not only its proud past, but also its future prospects with the city of Minneapolis, and whereas Augsburg College is celebrating its 125th anniversary throughout the 1994-95 academic year, now therefore be it proclaimed by the Office of City Council President of the City of Minneapolis that September 24th through 1994, through May 1995 be Augsburg College Heritage Year. Thank you.
When an institution celebrates an anniversary, it's easy to dwell on long ago history. Foundings and the struggle of early years make for quaint stories, stories which have the grit removed and a lot of romance added as the years pass, and we're no longer able to ask someone who was alive then what it was really like. But how lucky we are that someone who lived a very exciting time in Augsburg's history is with us tonight. Former President Oscar Anderson led Augsburg from 1963 until 1980. In turbulent times, he redefined Augsburg and advanced the institution by improving facilities and forging the connection between the campus and the greater community. Now, 200 students study, eat, sleep, and maybe even have a little fun in the residence hall that bears his name, Anderson Hall. To further examine and celebrate our past, please welcome President Emeritus Oscar Anderson.
Thank you, Donna. Augsburg was 65 years old when I came here as a freshman. It was our privilege to celebrate the centennial 25 years ago. And now the good Lord has given me the privilege of being a part of the 125th. I count it a real privilege. I have been given 5 to 7 minutes to cover 125 years. My only comfort is that they haven't given Chuck Anderson any more time. But while I mention him, I want to say something, and I don't want this to count on my 7 minutes. I tell you that Augsburg has come a long way since 1980. And the show Anderson 2 is better than the show Anderson 1. And I congratulate him and all of his cohorts in what is happening on this campus, and no one is more pleased than I. How can you celebrate 125 years in a few minutes? Help me do this by considering the spirit of these 125 years. At some time in your history and mine, these two histories have intersected. The result is memory. Memories that are satisfying, memories that are life-changing. Some people who went here majored in pre-wed. We heard about that tonight. Some are very tender memories. Some are humorous memories. When I was a freshman here in 1934, the president of this institution showed me how to put my toe rubbers on without bending over. That's a good part of a liberal education. But we have no time to rehearse stories, and I know the temptation since I have reached my anecdotage. But memories such as we carry with us can degenerate into nostalgia, and they must not. but memories are a working dynamic. If they open again our ears to hear the spirit of Augsburg, it is the spirit of fortitude. The history of Augsburg is marked by a fierce spirit of determination to overcome all odds, and those odds have come aplenty. There is no better personification of the spirit of fortitude than the founder of this institution, August Venus. We have already heard about what he went through. A man who for 7 years birthed and nurtured this institution. This institution is here because he had the courage and the tenacity to continue as pastor, teacher, writer, administrator, and churchman, bringing the college from Paxton to Marshall to Cooper's Attic and to Minneapolis. I believe that after 125 years, it is well to give August Venus his just due. The spirit of Augsburg is the spirit of freedom. Freedom is a consistent heartbeat at this institution. The Sverdrups had a name that was synonymous for the struggle for liberty in Norway in the early 1800s. And the Sverdrups who came here inherited the fire of freedom. Augsburg came to stand for freedom. In fact, one of its critics 100 years ago said, there is too much freedom at Augsburg College. Augsburg carries the tradition of freedom from intellectual, political, and ecclesiastical domination. The free church, in terms of the free congregation, is still an essential component which is sometimes threatened in our day by organizational overlay and ecclesiastical pressure. The truth shall make you free was in the old chapel in Old Main. Commencements have heard over and over again the highest aim in life is truth. And in 1869, we took the motto, through truth to freedom. The spirit of Augsburg is the spirit of freedom. It is also the spirit of openness, a corollary to freedom. The challenge and the courage and the spirit to face change. Recall some of the changes, changes of venue. Changes of constituency. It was in the 20s that women became a part of this college. 6 synodical affiliations have been a part of the college. A seminary, a college, and an academy finally merged and became a college in its own right. There has been a change in the relationship to the urban context, a change in the contacts with global realities. Yes, there were times, yes, there were, when Augsburg had the temptation to adopt a fortress mentality, to circle the wagons in order to maintain the status quo. But open minds, open hearts, open ears, open eyes, open hands prevailed. And to use Carl Krislock's phrase, in the last sentence of his History of Augsburg, here is a bold stance toward change, not least the change also in the complexion of the student body. I heard on television a few weeks ago a marvelous interview with Bonnie Wallace. Bless her heart, she is in charge of the American Indian program here at Augsburg College. And she was asked by the interviewer, what are you asked by prospective Native American students? And she said, they ask me if I have to be Lutheran and I have to cut my hair. And to hear her tell about the openness that this institution has to the people of her ethnic background thrilled my heart. There is also here a spirit of service. Education for service is that good infection which permeates the Augsburg community, past and present. When education turns in upon itself, it can become self-serving and even satanic. Genuine education must have deep roots and unselfish aims. Bernard Christensen called Augsburg a door to service. He wrote, service is a definite part of the Augsburg program. And thousands of graduates from this institution will not forget that. Finally, the spirit of Augsburg is the spirit of Jesus Christ. For 125 years, the gospel has been welcome here. The good news of God's love in Christ, as we see in the cross. This is the living leaven that has provided the true spirit of this institution. The Christian context is evident by the symbols we see on the top of the chapel and over at the science hall. The cross is there. The content of the gospel is made clear by teaching and preaching. And the compassion of the gospel has become incarnate in the people who give their unselfish service to this institution. It's the spirit of Christ that provides fortitude, freedom, openness, and service. And Augsburg is dedicated to that spirit without apology to anyone. Three questions haunt me. Does a college have a soul? The answer is yes, defined by its spirit. Can a college lose its soul? The academic landscape is littered with institutions that have lost their soul. But what does it profit a college if it has the highest endowment and the best buildings and the best faculty and the best student body and lose its soul? Will Augsburg lose its soul? It will keep its soul so long as it hears and heeds the spirit of these 125 years.
From academics and the high schools to Augsburg College we were cast, where we'll try and try forever to improve our lousy past. We are freshmen, and we're happy to be here. that will sing our praise to Augsburg with a voice so loud and clear.
To whom it may concern, we find ourselves living in the midst of many conflicting theories of what higher education, including Christian higher education, should be. Sincerely, Bernard Christensen, 1956.
To all freshmen.
All freshmen shall be in their rooms at 7:30 every night, except Sunday and one night during the week.
Permission to leave the dormitories must be obtained from proctors, house committees, the dean of men, the dean of women, or some fresh sophomore.
All freshmen shall be required to buy green caps and to wear them at all times on the campus, in the halls, and upon every occasion when they leave their rooms. Green caps must be worn at all athletic games.
All freshmen failing to pass their mid-quarter exams will receive 50 paddles for each exam they fail to pass. And those obtaining less than a C grade in all their classes will receive 10 paddles for every grade below C, including incompletes.
And failure to comply with all these rules or any one of them by any or all freshmen. Such freshmen will be tried before a court of sophomores where just punishment will be meted them.
Sincerely, the sophomore class of 1932.
Dear Mom, there's a week of freshman activities being planned for us, with the last of the scheduled welcoming activities being initiation. Of course, if we, the freshman class of 1960, can beat the sophomores in the annual tug of war, then we don't have to wear these green beanies. Even the word is demeaning. Beanie. Beanie, I hate it. Well, more later. Send money, love me.
Dear freshman class of 1959, as big and burly as we upperclassmen may seem to you, let me assure you that we want and need your fellowship. Perhaps you're wondering whether we really value your presence and participation in our religious life clubs on campus. I would banish your every doubt. We need you. We want you. Who else's heads can we shave? Just kidding. The best possible year to each of you, an upperclassman.
Dear Mom, well, 1927 is turning out to be quite a year. We've just celebrated our first homecoming. Henry Egbertson was chosen Ruder King, and Dorval Roon was named Ruder Prince. Both men are very curly-headed and quite peppy. The freshmen and sophomores met with a 100-yard dash, wrestling match, barrel races, high jump, wrestle royale, and a tug of war for the men. And a rooster chase for the women. Nuff said, your daughter.
Dear reader, it's 1943, and the theme for this homecoming, Yum Henyum, plans to teach next year. Now, who wouldn't like school with such a beauteous teacher as Miss Henyum? The Echo News.
Dear Echo, the name is LaVille, not Yum Yum. Very sincerely, LaVille Henyum, 1943 Homecoming Queen.
Dear Mom, I won the Ugly Man contest on campus. I'm part of the in crowd. Love you, me.
Dear Mom, guess what? I'm a member of the gospel team now. We leave tomorrow and go out among the congregations to sing and preach the word of God. The other men in the team said it's a great opportunity for us to learn and know the people who are supporting the free church. May the Lord continue to bless the gospel teams, especially now that I'm a part of them, your son.
To whom it may concern, even though it is 1920 and the world around us is moving at a dizzying rate, insofar as your query into co-education at Augsburg is concerned, I have one comment to make. Have you lost your mind? This idea of men and women together is contrary to all the principles upon which Augsburg is founded. After all, Augsburg is our Presteskula.
Co-education offers too many temptations toward frivolity and play.
It would be detrimental to the spiritual life of the school.
Sincerely concerned grads.
Well, dear concerned grads, let me say, if the next annual conference of the Lutheran Free Church says that Augsburg shall not open its doors to women, well, then that'll settle the question, won't it?
Gerda Martinson Hall, House Council Minutes, March 23, 1960. Our meeting was open with the reading and approval of last meeting's minutes, after which the treasurer's report was given. Mary Cherney appeared to appeal her room demerit. After discussion and much whining on Mary's part, we agreed to excuse her and remove the demerit. Also, the sewing machine committee gave the following rules. At the top of the list, no men. Respectfully submitted, Secretary.
To all women frosh, I'm Marion Fagree of the University Child Welfare Department, and I wanted to let you know about a talk I'll be giving in February on frosh women and their personality. I will go into some depth on the 10 factors of personality, which are liveliness, wide interest, intelligence, good sportsmanship, originality, athletic activity, humor, ability to take a hard knock, culture, and individuality. Dates was the topic of my last session. It was very successful. Two young men from the university's romance department told the women what boys expect of them and answered any questions. Sincerely, Marion Fagree, 1942.
Letter to the editor. We are sometimes called non-traditional students. I sometimes have trouble with this term. We participate in academic tradition just the same as any other student, except maybe having an easier time finding parking. We just don't happen to be participating in academic tradition at the traditional time in life. Sincerely, a weekend college graduate.
Dear editor, co-ed floor in Ernest Hall, I should point out that the two RAs on the co-ed floor have both emphasized that there have been no discipline problems. The men and women are mixing very well, no pun intended. There have been serious talks on such topics as roles and dating, but it seems that people have already been giving the co-ed floor a bad rap. It has been reported that certain religious groups on campus have been praying for those on the second floor. Signed, I can pray for myself, a co-ed floor resident.
To all Augsburg students, the Augsburg Student Handbook and Directory for 1933-34 shall set forth the code of conduct as follows.
Attendance at dances, either as participant, spectator, musician, or usher, will lead to expulsion.
Every student is earnestly urged to refrain from indiscriminate attendance at movies.
Drinking intoxicating liquors or patronizing pool halls will lead to expulsion.
Objectionable card playing is prohibited.
To all students, the Board of Regents has approved the introduction of social dancing as a part of the social and recreational program of Augsburg. The advantages of introducing social dancing far outweigh the disadvantages. Sincerely, the Board of Regents Secretary, 1965.
Dear Mom, well, I did it. I went to my first homecoming dance, which also happened to be Augsburg's first homecoming dance. And let me tell you, it probably go down as one of the most inhibited spectacles in the history of the school. Not only was I nursing an incredible guilt complex as I wondered how I could ever offend our alumni by holding such a pagan event, but now we're starting to wonder where the development money will come from. I don't think we have anything to apologize for, and at least we have one less taboo at Augsburg College, a taboo that previously fooled Augsburg students into believing themselves more Christian than the average swinger. Swing on. Love your son.
To the faculty, administration, and staff, cancel all meetings for the 15th of May, 1968. You're needed on campus the entire day. First, there will be no classes for students on May 15th. This will be our one day in May which we will use as an attempt to encourage our individual and collective response to the alarming and dangerous condition of racism in the United States today. Your refusal to actively participate in one day in May will be understood as your declaration in favor of racism, prejudice, and indifference in a time of crisis. Thank you, Oscar A. Anderson, President.
To whom it may concern, and it concerns all of us, to think and live globally, we have to understand the concept locally. If we talk diversity, we have to live it on campus. We must learn to grow and develop respect for our international family. If we are truly diverse, we will incorporate and accept differences in our daily lives. M. Anita Gay, Director of Black Student Affairs.
To whom it may concern, and it concerns us all, I have found a distinctly Lutheran college which had in its department of religion both a Jewish rabbi and a Roman Catholic priest. I found a distinctly Norwegian college, one which enrolled the third highest percentage of blacks in the state of Minnesota. I found a cafeteria which served Norwegian lutefisk and lefse on one Monday night and soul food on the next. Oh, I found all kinds of things.
To whom it may concern, and it concerns all of us, respect for difference, for diversity, may require serious action, that we loosen the bonds of our ethnocentrism, reduce the use of controlling statements and action, and seriously work to understand, respect, and support the rights and well-being of others in the context of their lives.
Do unto others as you would have them do unto you.
We love the school where we belong. We love to sing its praise. And if the melody of song may hearts to rapture raise, let Augsburg wear its loudest stem and Augsburg in our lungs. Resound in songs on every hand, in thanks to Him above.
As we mark the occasion of Augsburg's 125th anniversary, we contemplate our past, but we also ask ourselves, what next? That's often a difficult question to answer, one that requires an understanding of the essence of Augsburg and the capacity to envision its future. President Charles Anderson demonstrated these abilities from the moment he took office. In his inaugural address in 1980, he made the following statement, which I think you'll agree sounds as fresh today as it did then. One of the strengths of Augsburg has always been its diversity. We are a glorious company of individuals, all committed to high quality education. But I don't believe any three of us would or could walk in step for 100 feet as a matter of principle. We are not all the same, but we are all within the context of the love of God for all His creation, a love which enables us to question and study everything and to move beyond ourselves in learning and service. I present to you President Charles Anderson.
I'd like to say a couple of things without having it count against my time. Oscar could do that. First, as a one-time historian and theologian, I'm very concerned about accuracy, and I discovered that when I got back to my table that the material the staff had furnished me in describing the class of 1969 and their activities had been incomplete. My staff tends to protect me from certain types of news. You remember that paragraph about there were pies in the face, women in togas, apple polishing teas, et cetera, chopstick lesson. It should be amended by adding the words streakers. I'd also like to thank Oscar, I always call him Anderson Primus, for his characteristically gracious comments. Now you can count time if you want. As we look to the past and to the future, our task this evening at Augsburg and in all our days is to bring the themes of past and future together. To hold in tension, for example, the dictates of two grand Old Testament passages that have different contexts. In Jeremiah, it says, "The Lord says, stand by the roads and look and ask for the ancient paths where the good way is and walk in it and find rest for your souls." And on the other hand, in Isaiah, "Remember not the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it?" We are grateful for and enriched by our past. One of my favorite quotations that expresses this is from a medieval theologian, Ivo of Chartres. He said, "We are dwarfs standing on the shoulders of giants, and the reason we see so much farther than they is that we are borne up by their tremendous mass." We are grateful this evening for the past, but what can we say about the future? What do we embrace and why? While strictly speaking, we cannot embrace the future. What we embrace, that is, clasp to ourselves and hold fast, is here today, and this affects or shapes the future. If I choose to smoke two or three packs of cigarettes a day, chances are it will have an effect in some tomorrow. If one chooses to welcome and affirm differences, to reconcile rather than divide, it will have an effect. If one chooses economic means to benefit the whole rather than to develop or perpetuate a two-class society, it may well alter a future. If children are allowed or forced to roam the streets, there will be results. The question is, what do we wish to embrace today that will help create a humane and future that is filled also with hope? To be carried into this type of future, we must embrace at least two things, I believe. First, we must be aware of the need for what we are doing and embrace the tasks that meet that need. I have been at Augsburg for about 18 years now, and I have become more convinced every year that if this school should somehow just disappear, someone would have to recreate it. It is not just that educational programs and places are needed. There are over 3,000 colleges and universities in this country with whom we share some common concerns and aspirations. There are many schools, but we are speaking tonight of how some special qualities and gifts, how these are needed, and this place is needed. You talk to business planners, the first question they lay to you is, what business are you in? You have to decide what business you are in. Well, I have always argued that Augsburg is in the opportunity business. We can provide opportunities for our students because we have seized upon them ourselves. Let me illustrate. Our society is changing. For better or worse, we are becoming more urban each year. Most colleges our size are in small towns or in the open country. Even those who happen to be located in cities often display a cloistered mentality that denies their place. Being a college of the city is really a matter of attitude, more than a matter of geography. by recognizing the values and challenges of urban life, and by affirming the beauty of difference and diversity without slipping into relativism or tribalism, we provide opportunities for humane, productive life in our growing urban centers, and for sharing of beauty and strength from many traditions and races, thus enriching the whole social structure. By recognizing the values and needs of the individual, we provide an education with a human face and go counter to the movement toward a faceless and impersonal mass peopled by modular, that is, interchangeable persons who are only cogs in a technological machine. Our economy is changing. The immigrant dream of each generation being better off, of sharing more of the largesse of the new world, of moving up the economic ladder, has become more elusive and less certain. Some argue that we are in fact moving toward a two-class society, the rich and the poor, the haves, the have-nots, those with power and those without, and that the inevitable results are poverty and crime. What is to be done about poverty and crime? I think that the surest way out and up is not through welfare or punishment, but through quality education. Augsburg is in the opportunity business. It educates persons for meaningful work, it provides aid for those who need it, and it is an hospitable place for all people, not only a few. We recognize that education is costly, but it costs far less to have a student at Augsburg for a year than to have a prisoner at Stillwater or Shakopee for the same period. Higher education is an investment. Studies of the 1990 census data clearly indicate that the median income of persons who hold a baccalaureate degree was nearly twice that of a person with no college education. It was compared 33,000 to 17,000. We do not believe here that some persons should be programmed to be less than they are able to be and so cut off from the American dream. This is an opportunity place. We are concerned about societal needs in the changing economy. As a liberal arts college, we are primarily concerned with what a graduate is like as a person, not simply what she or he can do. Augsburg is a place of opportunity. Opportunity to learn about the connections that hold civilized people together in community. Connections of appreciation for other times and other cultures. Of understanding of what is beautiful, of understanding how groups work and people think, of an understanding of the power of language to hold us together in a civil and humane whole, and of the wonder of the created order and our responsibility for its care. This is a place of opportunity to discover things that transcend the self, to push back our horizons and open us up to the needs of others. It is a place where the bothersome ought questions are asked, these questions that characterize the ethical life. It is a place where we offer opportunities not simply to prepare for work, but also to see life as a calling, a vocation that gives purpose and meaning. Ernest Boyer, in a speech given in March of this year, commented, quote, "I believe that students in a church-related college should graduate understanding that the tragedy of life is not death. The tragedy is to die with commitments undefined, with convictions undeclared, and with service unfulfilled," close quote. Augsburg offers opportunity to see value that transcends the self and to begin a new life. When we speak of a new life, we are led to consider the second basis for an embrace which carries into the future. It is a focus upon which everything else we do depends. For we are not only to understand and affirm what we are doing and its need, we are also filled with gratitude for what God has done, with confidence in God's promises, and with a passion to be obedient to his graceful commands. We are confident, as the psalmist puts it, that God will fulfill his purpose for us. It is a marvelous thing to be involved in something greater than oneself, more important than a course or a degree, more telling than an endowment or a budget. As the church in its educational mission here on Riverside Avenue, we are called to service, to lives of forgiveness, to ministries of reconciliation and justice, and to care for this beautiful creation. Our means of rendering the service, of fulfilling this ministry and caring for this creation are found in this place and in our statement of mission. The past could be whatever we make it. It can be either a wall that restrains, a burden that hinders, or an entryway into a challenging and promising tomorrow. For us, the past is prologue. I want to conclude with a story I heard recently about a village elder who was reputed to be a very wise person. Two young boys in the village decided to play a little game, to have a little fun, and to test the old one and prove that she was really not that wise. They agreed between themselves that they would catch a small bird. Then one of them would hold the bird like this as the two went to the elder. They would then tell her that they had a bird and ask if it were dead or alive. If she said it is dead, the boy would open his hands and the bird would fly away. If she said it is alive, he would squeeze his fingers together and then open his hands to show the dead bird. In either case, the elder would be wrong. They caught the bird and went to the elder. They began, "We have a bird. Is it alive or dead?" The old woman looked at them, paused, and then answered, "It's in your hands." We receive the past with gratitude. The future is in large measure in our hands. The future of Augsburg requires will. Very few things happen by accident. It requires partnerships. Very few things are done alone. It requires support. Everything costs something. Above all, it requires a recognition that what we do is needed, and a recognition that we are each objects of infinite love and do have a purpose beyond ourselves. These things are, in fact, what we celebrate and embrace tonight. Thank you.
Good friends of the Augsburg community, we are here tonight not only for homecoming, and we're certainly here for that, but we're also here to celebrate the 125th birthday of this wonderful institution. So we would like to sing Happy Birthday, but we would like you to join us. Will you do that? You recognize the tune? Maybe you can bring down that sound. All right. Here it is.
Oh, come on, everybody.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Augsburg. Happy birthday to you.
Let's hear it for Augsburg College. Dessert is now being served.
We invite you to enjoy the birthday cake, and I present to you the Augsburg Jazz Ensemble, directed by Robert Stack.
Hello?
Testing, testing. Good evening. We're the Augsburg Jazz Ensemble, and we are very pleased tonight to present to you an array of alumni that have been performing in the Twin Cities and around the country. And we're going to start this evening's performance with Connie Evenson, who is performing with More by Four, and her arrangement of Something's Coming. Thank you. Let's greet Connie.
Could be, who knows, there's something due any day, I will know right away, soon as it shows, down the sky gleaming its eye bright as a rose, who knows. It's only just out of reach, down the block, on a beach, under a tree. I got a feeling there's a miracle due, gonna come true, coming to me. Coming right here to me. Yes, would it be? Yes, it could. Something's coming, it's something good, if I can wait. Something's coming, I don't know what it is, but I know it's gonna be great. With a click, with a shock, phone will jingle, the door will knock, open the latch. something's coming, I don't know, but it's soon. Catch the moon, one-handed catch. Around the corner, whistling down the river. Well, come on, won't you come and deliver to me? Shoot.